Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Amen. Today I want to share on a topic called living sacrifice. Amen. I would really encourage you to take notes and the verses. It's really going to bless you. Amen. When we understand this part, we will live such a life of liberty. Amen. Hallelujah. So what is sacrifice? Even in our Indian tradition, what do we do when we go to when we used to go to temple or church or wherever, we give a sacrifice, right? What do we do with the sacrifice? How do we give the sacrifice to God? What are the attributes like? What do we do? What are things? No, that is the material, but how do we give it? First, we ensure that we give it in a very clean thing, right? It should be a very clean thing. It is the first and the best thing, right? We do all these things and we take that sacrifice. Okay, before even eating that, we give it to God first before taking it. That's what we used to do, right? That's our tradition, right? So, what the important aspects of sacrifice is, it should be clean and it should be the best. That's the way we give the sacrifice, right? Let's read in Leviticus 1:9. I'm going to quote a lot of verses. We will take enough time to meditate on this topic, okay? Because it is really going to bless us. Leviticus 1:9.
But his inwards and his legs shall be washed in water. And the priest shall burn all on the altar to be a burnt sacrifice, an offering made by fire. Unto the Lord.
Amen. So it talks about giving a lamb or whatever that they are bringing to the temple. It is talking about the sacrifice, the way that they were offering the sacrifice in the Old Testament, right? In the temple, right? And it talks about you have to wash it first, okay? And then it is burnt on the altar, right? And then it becomes a sweet aroma to the Lord. Amen. So that is what we see. So we see here the aspect of washing, which is nothing but making things clean before giving it to God. Right? We don't want anything to be looking dirty or ugly. That's the way they were bringing the sacrifice to God. Amen. Okay. So in New Testament, let's read in Romans 12, 1 and 2. Romans 12, 1 and 2.
Therefore, I urge you, brothers, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as living sacrifices, holy and pleasing to God. This is your spiritual act of worship. Do not conform any longer to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is. Is good, pleasing and perfect will.
Amen. So here we can see two things. One is present your bodies and then renewing of mind. Okay, first is presenting your bodies, which is acceptable to God, and then the second is renewing of mind, so that you will know what is good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Okay, so there are two things that Paul is writing here. One is body and one is mind. Okay, so in our life, how does our action, see, we do things, we do actions out of our body, right? Do we just do suddenly? We will plan things. We will think about it first and then only we do things, right? So if our mind is perfect, our actions also will be perfect, right? So the renewing of mind is very important here. Amen. Because the Bible says, Proverbs 23:7, it says, for as he thinks in his heart, so is he. So if you think that you are righteous, you are holy, that's how you will act also. Okay. If you think that you are always a sinner, then you will tend to do more sin. If you think that I am accepted by God, then you will do the action also accordingly. Amen. So Proverbs 23:7 says, "For as he thinks in his heart, so is he." So is he means how people will see a person only by his actions. They will not read his mind, right? The way that he is acting, that's what will show how that person is, right? If a person is doing a lot of generous work, that's how we'll know that okay, he is having a good heart. If he just has a good heart and doesn't do anything, then people will not know about it, right? So that is what it is. So we are going to see about the things of how to renew the mind, because renewal of the mind is the one which is going to make us do the right actions. Amen. Are you all with me? Okay. So renewing of the mind is the one which is going to make us the right action. Many people just quote this verse, Romans 12, 1 and 2. It just says, okay, present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service, right? And do not be conformed to this world, transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is good, acceptable and perfect will of God. They just quote it. So you're just clueless, like, okay, it talks about purifying and renewing the mind and present your bodies as living sacrifice, but how to do it, right? That's what really matters, right? Unless you explain the things of what God has done and how you are renewed in your mind and how you can present your bodies as living, how to do it, people will be just confused. People can take their own standards. For my standard, this is my holiness. For another person, this is holiness. What is the standard? Then the other person higher will say, hey, you are not perfectly holy, right? You are of little less standard to me. There probably a pastor who is higher holy, he might say, no, you are not holy to like the way that I am, right? There's no standard. Everybody can just say, quote this verse, and there is no standard at all. Amen. So we need to understand what is the holiness that God is talking about here. Paul is quoting here. Amen. First, renewing of mind. let's read Hebrews 11:6. Hebrews 11:6. Probably one can take the mic.
Without faith, it is impossible to please God, because anyone who comes to Him must believe that He exists and that He rewards those who earnestly seek Him.
Amen. So it says, without faith, it is impossible to please God. Okay, why we are taking the sacrifice to God? When Paul is also writing that present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable, what happens after that? When we do like that, what happens? God is pleased. God is pleased. But the word says, without faith, it is impossible to please Him. Okay, so if your sacrifice is not mingled with faith, it's going to be worthless, right? So that is what Paul is talking. So it says, for he who comes to God, what you do during sacrifice? You go to God, right? You go to God and then just lay before Him. Even when we come to church, we believe that we are coming to God as a body together, right? That is what we are doing. So when we are coming to church also, and if we don't mingle that sacrifice, when we are praising and worshipping God, it is not mingled with faith, what happens? That sacrifice is not acceptable to God. Amen. So that is what Paul is saying here. For example, when we come to church, assume you have gone through, you have done some mistake in the past week. Okay. You come to worship God because it's a religious duty on Sunday morning that I have to come to God. Okay. I have to go to worship. Then you come here and your heart is saying, then what standard you have that you are coming before God now? So you'll worship, you'll just sing song, but your heart and mind is keep on condemning you, right? And what happens? There is no faith at all there. There is no, the faith is not mingled in your worship. Because when we worship God in faith, when we worship God, that God is accepting our sacrifice, otherwise how will you believe, right? See, when we worship God freely, we really, when we pour out to God, you really feel that Lord, I have worshipped you today, right? But if without that, if you believe that and your heart is condemning you and your mind is condemning you, you would have just prayed, you would have just worshipped, okay? You would just sang song, I would say you would have worshipped, you would have just sang song, but there is no faith in it. And you will feel condemned even more. Now, I even sang the song also, and it is worthless because it is not mingled in faith. Amen. So, what happens is, when we worship God, we want to draw closer to God, we take one step forward, and our heart and mind is condemning us, so we go two steps backward. So, this dancing is going on in our mind and heart. Okay. We take one step, there's a good song is coming, and 10,000 reasons for my heart to fight. So you feel good about it and you take one step and your mind is saying, what 10,000 reasons you have done some mistake last week? What is the 10,000 reason? 10,000 mistakes you have done last week and you are coming closer to God. So your mind is condemning you there. So you're going away from God, two step back. So this battle is going on, this dancing is going on in your mind. Okay, when we think that God is not accepting us, our worship, we are doing this dance forward and backward, by the time the worship will be over. Okay, and sometimes the service also will be over. And you will go back even more content, man, what a waste of time, I went there and I did not really worship God also because I felt that God has not accepted me and I am going back even more content. That is what is happening in many believers' life. Okay, so we need to understand that without faith, it is impossible to please Him. Those who come to God, we need to know that we have to come to God in faith, not in fear, not in guilt and condemnation. Amen. Let's read this verse, Isaiah 29:13.
The Lord says, these people come near to me with their mouth and honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. Their worship of me is made up only of rules taught by men.
Amen. Period. Well, it's superbly given, right? See, when people, what are the rules taught by men? Hey, you have to be holy. When you come to God, you have to be holy. You have to be perfect. Nobody is, the person who is telling us is not perfect. Okay, that's the truth. Okay, it's a rule, it's a commandment of man. It says like this in NKJV. In as much as these people draw near with their mouths and honor me with their lips, but have removed their hearts far from me. Amen. So what is happening during worship? We're just singing. Our mouth is singing. Our heart is away. Heart is condemned and away from God. Somewhere roaming around here and there. Okay. And their fear toward me is taught by commandment of men. Okay, so there is a fear involved and it is taught by the commandment of men. Men are teaching that you have to be perfect, you have to fear God when you come before Him. Okay, that's the way people are teaching, but they really don't tell what is our holiness, from where our holiness comes from, how we become holy every day, and how we need to make ourselves holy every day so that we can worship God truly. Amen. Just by quoting saying that you have to be holy, you have to be perfect before God, no, nobody will understand what does it mean. Okay, as I said, there is a different level of holiness for everybody, right? And one person who is higher can always condemn the lower, saying that you are not perfect to my standard, my holiness standard, you are waste, right? And that person will go back condemned, right? So we have to teach the church how we are holy and we are being made holy. Amen. How God has done His work, how our mind has to be renewed with this truth day and night so that we know how to worship God and how to make ourselves as a living sacrifice to God. Amen. So that is what you are going to see today, and I believe when you know this truth, the truth will set you free. You will enjoy the life, you will enjoy the worship, and you will live such a life of liberty. Amen. Hallelujah. So here, what we are seeing as a stumbling block for coming near to God. We saw a few things. Can you name a few? What are the things that are making? So as we saw the dance, right? A person is taking one step and then going two steps back. What are the things that are playing role in making a person moving away from God?
Fear.
Fear. Guilt. Condemnation. And doubt. Doubt, right? Oh, is really God loving me? Is really God caring for me? Right? All the, when fear comes, then automatically these are also will come. Yeah, when guilt and condemnation comes, automatically you will start fear because the people will go, oh, you should be more holy. You will not meet that bar. You will never know what is that bar. What is that standard? You will never know about it. Right? And you will always feel condemned. Right? So, what are the things that evil and sin conscience, guilt and condemnation, fear, doubt. So these are the things that are taking you away from God. But you want to give a living sacrifice. Paul is talking about a living sacrifice. If you're taking off, if you're taking your body away from God with these things, how will you give a living sacrifice? You cannot give. You cannot make yourself as a living sacrifice to God. Amen. Because all these thoughts are driving you and taking you away from God. Amen. So our mind is the doorway for all these things. Okay, either because of these things, what will happen? You feel, probably I will skip church today, I am not feeling good. I am feeling more guilt and condemned, so let me skip church today. Or because of the religious attitude, you will be there, but you would have not been benefited at all. We'll just go back even more miserable. Amen. So see, this is a constant cycle that is happening among believers. Amen. We need to renew our mind. So we are going to see in detail how to renew our mind. Okay. The word of God says that you shall know the truth and the truth shall set you free. You shall know the truth shall set you free. First truth is, we are already sanctified. We are already made holy. That's the truth. Whether people believe it or not, whether you believe it or not, you are already holy because when you accepted Jesus Christ. That's the first truth. Okay. There is a second truth called, we are being sanctified till we meet Jesus Christ. We are being sanctified. See, I'm going to tell all this from the word of God. I'm not cooking up a story here. Okay. When we know this truth of the word of God, the truth will set us free. Amen. So we are going to see this from the word, that there are two truths. One is, when we accepted Jesus Christ, we are being made holy. We are made holy. Without which there is no salvation. Okay. We are already sanctified. We are already made holy. That is the first truth. There is a second truth. That is where our renewing of mind needs to come. When that renewing of mind keep on happening, we are being sanctified. We are being made holy till we meet Jesus Christ. Amen. So, we need to know this truth. Okay. How we are already sanctified? Let's read Colossians 1:21.
And you that were sometime alienated and enemies in your mind, now have been reconciled. The body of his flesh through them, present you holy and unblameable and reproachable in his sight.
Above reproach. Yeah, right. Yeah, go ahead.
If we continue in the faith grounded and settled, and be not moved away from the hope of the gospel,
hallelujah. See, it talks about you were being alienated and enemies in your mind. How we are enemies in our mind? When we draw, whether two enemies will meet each other, enemies will always fight, right? Even if they meet, they are meeting or fighting, or they will always want to keep them separated. Okay, that is how we were, that we were enemies in our mind. We did not know God. Or even when we knew God, we always know that God is always against us. Okay, that is how we were. And some pathetically, even after becoming believers also, we are like this sometimes. That God is not loving me. God is hating me. Okay, so we were alienated and enemies in our mind by wicked works. Yet now, who Jesus Christ has reconciled in the body of his flesh through death to present you holy and blameless and above reproach in his sight. What he is doing is presenting. So even though we are running away from God, Jesus is catching us and then presenting us holy before God. This is how my son is, because I have watched him now. Okay, this is the truth. This is the truth that we need to know, that we are already sanctified. Though the renewing mind comes next, okay? But the truth is, when we accepted Jesus Christ, we are washed and Jesus is presenting us holy and blameless. How the sacrifice should be? It should be pure, the best. So Jesus is making us as holy and blameless and without reproach to God in his sight. Amen. What it says, if indeed you continue in the faith. See, again the faith is coming into thing here, because the faith has to come into aspect. Because what happens when we accepted Jesus Christ, we are in faith. Okay, that's the first faith that we had. When we accepted Jesus Christ, we believed that, Lord, you have paid for all my sins and accept you as my Lord and Savior. That comes out of faith. Okay, so because of that faith, Jesus is presenting with that faith to God, holy and blameless. Amen. That's the way that we were the day that we got saved. And we are continuously that we are when till we meet Jesus Christ. Okay, so always it has to be mingled with this faith that Jesus has paid the price on the cross and I am made holy by his work, his sacrifice, and I am being made presented before God holy and blameless and above reproach. Okay, so that's the faith. So it clearly gives a warning there, right? 123 it says, if indeed you continue in the faith, you have to continue in that faith, you need to know and you need to believe that Jesus Christ paid the price for my sins. That's the faith that we need to have. Amen. So this is one of the beautiful words that we had. Let's go to 2 Thessalonians 2:13. 2 Thessalonians 2:13.
But we ought always to thank God for you, brothers loved by the Lord, because from the beginning God chose you to be saved through the sanctified work of the Spirit and through belief in the truth.
Amen. Hallelujah. So again, belief in the truth, faith in the work of Jesus Christ. Okay, and it says that because God from the beginning chose you for salvation through sanctification by the Spirit. Okay, so God sanctified us. So we saw, right, when we accepted Jesus Christ, there are many things that are happening there, okay, to make us presentable to God in a holy and above reproach. Jesus is sanctifying us by the Spirit. That is what it says here, right? Brethren, beloved by the Lord. See, beloved is a great word, okay. Nobody in Old Testament were called as beloved. Many people are not called as beloved. You see very selected people like Daniel, David. Not all the people are called beloved. But it says the people who are accepted Jesus Christ, it says the beloved by the Lord, brethren, beloved by the Lord, because God from the beginning chose you for salvation through sanctification. So sanctification is what? Made holy. Okay, so till our part has not come, the day we accepted Jesus Christ, when we accepted that he has paid the price for our sins, we are sanctified by the Spirit of God for making us a living sacrifice to God. Amen. So we need to know this truth, that first Jesus Christ paid the price, right? And second, we are sanctified by the Spirit of God. We are made holy by the Spirit of God. That sacrifice that we are making ourselves to God is being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. Amen. Okay. Let's read Hebrew. Let's read 1 Peter 1:2. First Peter 1:2. One can take Acts 26:18.
Elect according to the foreknowledge of God the Father, through sanctification of the Spirit, unto obedience and sprinkling of the blood of Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
Grace unto you.
Yes.
And the peace be multiplied.
Yeah. So this also talks about elect according to the foreknowledge of God the Father through the sanctification of the Spirit. Okay. So we are elected by God through the sanctification of the Holy Spirit. See, man's part is not even coming here. I'll come to that part later. You need to understand that all this work is done by Jesus Christ and the Spirit of God for our sanctification. We will not be able to stand before God without their work first. Okay, so we are seeing all these verses to know what is the work of the Holy Spirit, what is the work of Jesus Christ, and how we are made righteous when we accepted Jesus Christ through faith. Okay, so our part here is only the faith that Jesus paid the price. That is the only part. Otherwise, everybody would be sanctified, right? Every unbeliever also be. So our part there is only the faith. We accept, we open our mouth and confess that Jesus Christ is our Lord. That's the only part. But all other things of how He is making us holy is being explained here. Amen. Let's read Acts 26:18.
Open their eyes to turn them from darkness to light and from the power of Satan unto God, that they may receive forgiveness of sins and inheritance among them which are sanctified by faith that is in me.
Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It says, and that they may receive the forgiveness of sins and an inheritance among who are sanctified by faith in me. So we saw different ways we are being sanctified. Sanctified by the Spirit of God, sanctified by our faith when we accepted Jesus Christ, and the work of Jesus on the cross. Amen. Hallelujah. So are we getting it? See, all these are talking about our holiness. How God is making us sanctified and holy for making ourselves an acceptable thing before God, a living sacrifice before God. See, we need to understand this truth, okay? Otherwise, we will try to reach a standard we will never attain. And that will always keep us discouraged. That will always keep us confused. What is that holiness standard, Lord? Right? See, that standard has to come from God Himself. Because He is the standard. And if we are trying to say that, oh, I did this one, that's why I am becoming holy. And another person will say, I did something else, that's why I became holy. Where is the standard? There should be a standard, right? Right. So that is what, so God has made the standard. And the standard is what we are talking about here, the sanctification. How we are being sanctified, okay? Let's read Hebrews 10:10. See the work of the Holy Spirit, the work of Jesus Christ in all these places. Go back and meditate on these verses just when you know that.
By that will we have been sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once for all.
Amen. We have been sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. Okay. How we are made holy? Through the offering of Jesus Christ. Okay. This is beautifully explained here of how. So when we know these things, right? God, it's not about me. You have done so many things for making me holy, right? And you have done such a marvelous thing, and we are negating all those your work, and we are trying to stand in our own holiness. I'll come to our part where we are being made holy through the renewing of mind. I'll come to that part. But we need to understand this truth that, Lord, your work is not something small. You have, when you paid the price and when you said it is finished, it's not a small joke, right? You have sanctified us through your body. You have sanctifying us by the faith in you. You are sanctifying us by the Spirit of God. And that's how we are made acceptable to God. Right? When we know this truth, right, I believe you will live such a joyful life. Such a life without condemnation and guilt. And even if there is anything that you are struggling with, you will definitely overcome. I bet you will definitely overcome that struggle when you know this truth. Because you need to know that it is not by our effort without the strength of God which is going to make us perfect. We need to know the truth, and when we are renewed in our mind, the action will automatically follow. We will be holy in our doings as well. Amen. Hallelujah. So Romans 15:16. Romans 1, one can take John 17. I'm going to give you these verses so that you will know, and you will know the work, the great work that Jesus Christ has done on the cross. Romans 15:16.
That how might be a minister of Jesus Christ to the Gentiles, ministering the gospel of God, that the offering of the Gentiles might be acceptable and sanctified by the Holy Spirit.
Wonderful. Right? That the offering of the Gentiles might be acceptable, sanctified by the Holy Spirit. See, we are talking about living sacrifice, an offering. Okay. So Romans 15:16 says that I might be the minister of Jesus Christ to the Gentiles, ministering the gospel of God, that the offering of the Gentiles, what is it? Are they bringing some food or something to God every day? Paul is talking about present your bodies as a living sacrifice to God. We are offering ourselves to God. Okay, and that is what he's talking about here. So the offering of the Gentiles might be acceptable, which is sanctified by the Spirit of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Sanctified by the Holy Spirit. So when we preach the gospel, whatever offering that we make through worship, when we are worshiping, we are offering to God. We are making holy sacrifices to God. Amen. We are a royal priesthood. In Peter it says that we are the royal priesthood, we are the holy nation. Priest, what the priest will do? Priest will go and give the sacrifice, offer. Okay, so that is what, and if you read in Peter, I think 1 Peter I believe, it says that we are the holy nation, a royal priesthood, a special treasure, a special people to proclaim the praises of the living God. That's the sacrifice. Amen. So God has made us priests to give the sacrifice to Him. Amen. And that complete work is done by the Spirit of God and Jesus Christ when they paid the price on the cross. When He paid the price on the cross and we accepted it. That's the only part from us. We accepted Jesus Christ. Right? That's the only part from us. So, let's read John 17:19.
And for thy sakes, I sanctify myself, that they also might be sanctified through the truth.
Amen. Hallelujah. So it talks about Jesus Christ, that He is consecrating. So here the sanctification is that He is going as a sacrifice to God. Right? He is sanctifying Himself for as what? That He will present and He will go and die on the cross. It's like going and being given as a sacrifice in the altar. So he is talking about even before his death, even before his crucifixion, he is saying that I sanctify myself as a what? For what? He doesn't need anything to be made holy, but he is going there as an offering, as a Lamb of God. The Lamb of God has to be sanctified before it is given on the altar, right? So he is sanctifying himself as a Lamb of God. So that for what? That they may be sanctified. Who? We. We believers sanctified by the truth. This truth. That we believe it. Wonderful, right? Hallelujah. So it all talks about His work. Most of the things are talking about His work. 1 Corinthians 6:11. This is a beautiful verse. 1 Corinthians 6:11.
That is what some of you were, but you were washed, you were sanctified, you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and by the Spirit of our God.
Hallelujah. It is not even talking about a future tense. You were washed, you were, past tense. You were washed, you were sanctified, and you were justified. You were already justified. Okay, now we are talking about how to make, you are already a living sacrifice. When Jesus paid the price, you are already a living sacrifice. Amen. Hallelujah. So, see, when we know this truth, that, see, I tell you, we believers are the most beautiful hypocrites. Okay. We try to mess around with people with a lot of wrong things. Okay. When we know this truth, the truth will set us free. Amen. We are already sanctified by the Spirit of God. We are already sanctified. It talks about the Spirit of God. Through His blood, He has sanctified us. Through His body, He has sanctified us. And through the faith in Him, He sanctified us. Amen. He has made us perfect and acceptable to God as to give us a living sacrifice. Amen. Hallelujah. So many times, see, we underestimate the work of Jesus Christ. That's why we say that we preach the finished work of Jesus Christ, which means that this is what the finished work, what he has done for us. We sometimes take the salvation part of what the role that Jesus has paid us so little, and we focus on our work so high, it diminishes the work and the great work of God. Amen. When we know this, see, the work of Jesus Christ not only forgave our sins, it made us as a children of God. See, a children of a father, he will get the best out of whatever he could get from the father, right? And we are the children of God, we will get the best from God. That's how our mind should be renewed. Okay, so the sacrifice of Jesus Christ not only gave us from the forgiveness of sins, like, okay, chalaya, okay, you are forgiven, go. Not like that. He has forgiven us and made us his children so that we can get the best out of him. That's the understanding we should have. It is as if, like, oh, okay, I got saved. Okay. You are forgiven, man. You accepted, right? Go. What? You're belittling it so small. That's the great work of Jesus Christ. Amen. And when we know this, right, we will live in such a liberty. Amen. So Romans 5:8, let's read this. Romans 5:8.
But God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us.
Amen. So his love is given and shown upon us when we were sinners. Okay. When we were still sinners, he loved us so much that he made Jesus Christ to pay the price. Okay, he died for us, right? So then how we will think that after we are accepted, we are becoming going away from God? He showed us love when we were sinners, right? We were like such a rejected people. We are doing our own stuff. It talks right in Colossians 1:21 that you who once were alienated and enemies in your mind. We were like enemies to God. At that time, God has loved us. See, a sinner cannot see God. That is what the word of God says. When we were sinners, God sent Jesus Christ because he loved us and he made Jesus Christ as a sacrifice. Now we say, after we were accepted as a beloved, we think that, oh, God is not loving me. How hypocritical it is, right? God is loving us when we were sinners, and how God will not love us after we are accepted, right? So I think we need to break all those walls that is built in our mind to know who God is really. Amen. Hallelujah. Okay, so now you might ask that, what is the role of man then? Okay, so he accepted Christ, okay, it's all over. I'll come to that part. Okay, so this is the second part of being sanctified. So I was telling about a part how we were already sanctified through the work of God. Now we'll come to the part of how we are being sanctified. Okay, so let us come to the practicality of our holiness. Our holiness, let's come to that. Our life, everyday life. Okay, how many of us can boldly say on the day that from the day we accepted Jesus Christ, we became super holy? How many of us can say? Then nobody can reach heaven, right? Come on. We can never say that we became super holy from the day, like something God threw at us, that we changed to a new person now. We cannot even think of sin. How many of us can say? Nobody can say. If that is the case, then nobody will reach heaven. Right? So, see the different ways we can be defiled, we can become corrupted by the world. Okay, when we go on the road, we see some bad poster. We might have not seen it intentionally. Okay, we might have not seen it intentionally, But just seeing that poster, it just corrupted us. Our mind is corrupted. Okay, that picture could, like the whatever picture that we see, it can form as a thought in our mind suddenly. Then I became a holy person. I just accepted Christ. Oh, I can think of these things. Oh, sorry, probably I need to be saved again now. So you'll go and stand before another salvation prayer. Lord, if you do, you'll do that till your end of your life. Okay, so that is one way. When we see the internet, okay, when we want to go and book a flight ticket or a railway ticket or a bus ticket, there's something popped up suddenly. You are defiled. Can you put a filter in your eyes that, oh, these things are rejected? Suddenly it comes. You are not seeing it intentionally. Okay. So, see the way, I'll tell you how the guilt conscience gets built. Okay. When you go on the road, you saw something, the picture came into your mind. Okay. When you open the internet, even if you want to go look for a news website, some filthy news will be there. You just saw the new setting only, that's all. That itself will corrupt your mind. Come on, I'm telling you the truth. Okay, so that is one. You go to YouTube. You want to go and watch something good. Something bad will be there as a suggested video. Okay. Are you all experiencing this, or I'm only saying God is probably giving me special treatment here? Okay, let's come to the practicality. Okay, all these things will corrupt us. That's the truth. That's the truth. Okay. So if we don't know how to, it comes to us knowingly or unknowingly. Okay. What happens is, sometimes what we start doing is, our mind can process a lot of things. Okay. Even our dreams, it can process a lot of things. Okay. Our mind can process a lot of things. There could be some bad dream would come. So you will suddenly, God, how I was such a holy person, how these things can come to me? You need to know how to ignore certain things in your life. That's how you are being sanctified. You need to know how to renew your mind. See, you have to grow to a standard that even if something is on the road, you have trained your mind in such a way that it will not bother about that. First, you have not come to that maturity first. Okay, you would have seen something, you would have struggled with few things over a period of time. But when you renew your mind, what happens? You will start ignoring them. Your mind will automatically start, this is not required for me. That's the renewing of mind. If we don't think, if we don't teach about this, and if you order, hey, be holy, last night you had a bad dream, morning some pastor, be holy, don't come to God like this. God, that person is gone. So much condemnation now. Oh God, where will I go now? Right? We are fooling ourselves. That's what I would say. The churches these days are fooling ourselves. They're fooling the believers so much. If we are not teaching the believers how to renew the mind and how to ignore things, and see, it's a work of God that will work. I'll come to this part. Okay. So it'll be more interesting. Okay. So what happens when you start thinking like this? You had a dream. Your mind is sometimes processing this. You are sometimes thinking this, and you are now weak now. You are like shaking. Okay. Oh, when I'll fall. When you are in this kind of a mindset, you will definitely fall. You will definitely fall. I bet you will definitely fall. Okay. And what happens? You'll fall, then your condemnation will come. And then more condemnation, more falling. And more falling, more condemnation. This is a cycle. It'll keep going. And you will start ignoring church, you will not take phone calls, you will, brother, where are you? You will not respond to WhatsApp. Everything will happen. Okay. Every damn thing that needs to happen in a person's life will happen. Okay. And with that mind, you will not be able to focus on work. You will think that, Lord, I accepted you. Where I am now? I have fallen many times. You are now jumping in your spirit. Oh, Lord, what I have done. And you cannot tell this to another believer also. Oh, what this guy will think about me now? I am such a wicked person now. You will not know that he is also facing the same problem. Okay. You think that the special treatment are all happening to you alone. The special treatment is for everybody in this world. Okay. So that is what is happening. And okay, and one important thing. Have you seen that when you are more condemned, you eat more? Have you experienced it? You want to sin now. You want to eat whatever you want now. Okay. When people get condemned, okay, all wrong things will happen, not just about eating. You want to now go to anything, go and booze or go to wrong friends. What is there? Already fallen. What is the great falling will happen after going there alone? Already I'm fallen. I'm already in a ditch. So more and more things will happen. Okay. See, and Romans 14:23 says like this. Now one can take James 4:17. Romans 14:23.
But he who doubts is condemned if he eats, because he does not eat from faith. For whatever is not from faith is sin.
Yes. Period. Whatever you do without faith is sin. So even sometimes you rebel and do certain things of eating or going there, and all those things you are doing out of what? Frustration and faithlessness. Because you are now already decided that, sorry, God and me has no relationship now. You already decided that. Okay. And because of that, what you will do? You will do more and more sin, and all will happen because without faith. So word says, and whatever you do without faith is sin. So now you are more condemned. Oh, now this also is condemnation. Okay. So Bible itself is saying that whatever you do without faith is sin. So now I am doing all these things. I thought already fallen, now I am deep in an even deeper pit. Deeper sin. Okay. James 4:17.
Anyone that who knows the good he ought to do and doesn't do it sins.
See? So therefore, to him who knows to do good and does not do it, for him it is a sin. How many times you know what is good, and are we doing that all the time? So see, when we all these verses are talking about a wretched state of a man, okay, how much he needs to have God in his life. Okay, so all this, sometimes we can quote these all these things for our negative also. Oh, okay, I'm in a perfect condemnation now. I've reached a perfection in condemnation. Right? And you become such a condemnation and guilt filled depot that you will make other people also miserable now. Because if somebody gives a testimony of God has been faith, what I have also seen, and you will not be happy about it at all. You will never be joyful, and you wanted to make sure that, oh, I have fallen, what is the great thing that is there in you? You will also will fall. So you will always whenever you open your mouth, it is also always about condemnation now. Always you wanted to slam, because let me share the joy that I have received. Right? I have received so much guilt and condemnation. Let me share that to my brother. So you go and tell your standard of your, you know, this is the faith, this is the level of holiness you should have. You have not reached this. Oh, sorry, you are not perfect. You are not living a perfect life. Right? So we will share our joy with everybody. Okay, that is what most of the time happens, even from the pulpit also, that people share their joy of condemnation to everybody. Make everybody miserable, let them go out, make other people miserable. Okay, that is what happens. Okay, we need to tell what is right according to the word of God. Amen. And if you see, with such a kind of an attitude, we'll be more miserable than an unbeliever. Unbeliever will not even know, okay, these are all sin. He will have a good, cool life. We will call ourselves, oh, we are so holy and we are so Christians, and we will live such a miserable life that we will not be a testimony among, we will always be a sad, grumpy face. If we are not joyful, how other person will be able to know that we are living a good life? Joy is the expression of what is going on in our inside, right? And if that is always feeling guilty and condemned, how that you will always be grumpy, and then you will proclaim to other unbelievers also that, oh, when you become a Christian, you have to be like this only. He will hate you. Man, this guy, I don't want to be with this guy. Nobody wants to be with a person who is who is not joyful, right? People, why the party and all those things? Everybody wants to share the joy, right? And that's why you, people want to go to that place, right? And if everybody thinks that you are always grumpy and moody and you cannot share the joy, nobody wants to come to you, right? Everybody wants to, will hate you. So we have, in even in that standard, we are less joyful or no joy at all, even compared to an unbeliever. Amen. So, that is what happens. Okay, let's now see how to overcome all these things. See, all these things can bring condemnation, guilt, and frustration and faithlessness. And then where we can think of offering a sacrifice? We will run opposite direction in 100 miles. Where we will think of sacrifice? What you are talking, man? I am running the other side. How to draw close to God? Right? That's the way we will start thinking. Because we will start avoiding church, we will start avoiding believers, you will don't want to share, you are in a mess now. Right? So that's what happens. Okay. Now, let's see how to overcome these things. Okay. The answer for being sanctified. I was talking about two things. One is you are already sanctified, so we need to know that too. And the second is being sanctified. The answer for being sanctified is draw near to God. That's the answer for being sanctified. Amen. Hallelujah. So let's read this verse. James 4:8. James is like rebuking people here.
Draw nigh to God, and He will draw nigh to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded.
Yes, amen. First, what is happening? What is instructing? Draw near to God. You sinners, you, what is sin? Anything you do without faith is sin. That is what the words are, right? We saw, right? Anything that you do without faith is sin. Anything you know what is good and you don't do it is sin. So we have become a sinner now. So James is rebuking, guys, draw near to God. You sinners, you people who are running away, draw near to Him. You double-minded people, whether God is like this dance, one step forward, two step backward, right? It's a double-mindedness. You want to draw near to God and no, sorry. God is not accepted. It's a double-mindedness, right? So James is rebuking, draw near to God, right? And we need to near to Him. Okay, and he's talking about purify your hearts. Purify your hearts, right? Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, double-minded. How to purify our hearts? Acts 15:9 says this. Acts 15:9 talks about purifying the hearts. It says, and made no distinction between us and them, purifying their hearts by faith. What a wonderful way that it's talking about. How to purify yourself? You have to purify your hearts by faith. So, he's saying that with faith, draw near to God. You purify your hearts how? You purify your heart by faith, draw near to God. Amen. We just quote this verse. Draw near to God, He will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners. Purify your hearts, you double-minded. Just think of a person who has done something last week and you preach like this. Purify your hearts. What is the standard now? I don't know. So he will feel even more guilty, even more condemned while going back to home. Right? You purify the hearts by faith. You believe that the work of God, what He has done for you, and draw near to Him. Right? So that's the answer. So let's read a few wonderful verses that Paul is writing and it's mentioned in Bible. So let's read Hebrews 4:16. So the answer for being sanctified is what? Drawing near to God. So first we saw, we are already sanctified by the work of Jesus Christ. Second, being sanctified happens by the renewing of mind, right? And that happens by, when we are renewed in our mind by knowing this word, Through faith we will draw near to God. Okay, so drawing near to God is the answer for us to being sanctified. Let's read this.
Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need.
Yeah. He's writing very simply here. Why? When we need mercy, yeah? When we make mistake only we need mercy. So he's saying, therefore, let us therefore come boldly to, not like, oh, well, I have done some mistake, I will. No, he's saying, Lord, I need your help now. I will come boldly to your throne room of grace and I will receive the mercy and grace that is needed in the time of need. This is what will make you holy. Okay, not having some standard or man's standard. What it said, right, in Isaiah, that they fear according to the commandments of men, not according to the word. According to the commandment of men, they are fearing me. Come on. And we worship without our heart being with God. Right? So it talks about that, let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and the fine grace to help in time of need. So we need his mercy and grace, his empowerment, for us to not do the same mistake again later. Okay, not you thinking something, oh, some standard of holiness. It will never make you. Always draw to God for being sanctified. Amen. That is what Paul is writing here. Let's read Hebrews 10:19-22. Wonderful verse. Hebrews 10:19-22. let me read this. Therefore, brethren, having boldness to enter the holiest by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way, which he consecrated for us through the veil, that is his flesh, and having a high priest over the house of God, let us draw near with a true heart in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Amen. It talks about where he's talking to come. See, having boldness to enter the holiest. Where is the holiest? It's the most holiest place. Holy, where God is. Okay, he's talking, saying that, therefore, brethren, having boldness, he's talking about another boldness here. We saw in Hebrews 4:16 that we have to come boldly to the throne room of grace. Here, talking about another boldness, to enter the holiest. Holiest is the most holy place. Okay, by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way which he consecrated for us through the veil, that is his flesh, having a high priest over the house of God, let us draw near. Where? In the holiest place, he is asking to draw near to God. Come near to me. Right? Draw near with a true heart. Here also he talks about full assurance of faith. What it said, Hebrews 11:6, without faith it is impossible to please him. Amen. So we need to have the full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience. Because this guilt and condemnation conscience is the one is taking us away from God. And he's saying, go boldly now with the full assurance of faith that you will obtain mercy and grace in the time of need. Amen. See how we have made it complicated. Man, after becoming believers, we have made our life so complicated and miserable. For our holiness and sanctification, we need God's self. For first also we needed God's self, now also we need God's self. Without this we struggle, we condemn, we go through a lot of depression, no joy. God said righteousness, peace and joy in the Holy Ghost is the kingdom of God. We are not at all living in that kingdom most of the time. We are always again outsider, always an outsider. Oh, somebody is doing it. Okay. Right? Okay. Now, it's talking about washing, right? From an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. I really love this verse, Leviticus 16:24. Let's read this verse, Leviticus 16:24. Wonderful verse.
he shall wash his flesh with water in the holy place, and put on his garments, and come forth, and offer his burnt offering, and the burnt offering of the people, and make an atonement for himself and for the people.
See, it is talking about the Old Testament law. What this priest is doing, where he is washing his body? In the holy place. He is not washing, his body outside in his home and then coming to the holy place. He is washing his body in the holy place. Guys, listen. We can wash ourselves only in the holy place. Amen. If you are drawing away from God, running away from God, where you wash? Amen. It was already given in the Old Testament. You have to wash your body in the holy place. Amen. Wonderful. I was really like, wow, God, like, this is the truth. I need to know this. Amen. Hallelujah. Ephesians 5, 25 and 26. Ephesians 5, 25 and 26.
Husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church, and gave himself for it, that he might sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of water by the word.
Amen. Hallelujah. And next verse, 27 also.
That he might present it to himself a glorious church, not having spot or wicked, or any such thing, but that it should be holy and without blemish.
Amen. See, the work of Jesus Christ here. Husbands, love your wives just as Christ has loved the church and gave himself for her, that he might sanctify and cleanse her with the washing of water by the word. How he is washing? Through his word. Okay. And he is sanctifying us through his word. Because the word is the one which will set us free. The truth, word is the truth. And the truth is the one which will set us free. Amen. For what purpose? That he might present her to himself a glorious church. It's like as an offering, as a glorious church, without spot or wrinkle, without any wrong thing in it. Okay. So it is the work of Jesus Christ here. Amen. And he is doing this work. So how we will allow him to do the work? Only when we draw near to him. If we always run away from him, how he can do his work? Right? We are saying that, sorry God, my sin and my imperfection is so great than your work on the cross. That's what we say. When we draw away from God, when we are running away from God, we are saying, we are making God's work so little. Sorry God, your work is so small. My sin is so big. Sorry, you cannot do this. I am great now. Right? Hallelujah. So, in John 13:8, he said to the Peter, Peter said, you shall never wash my feet. Jesus answered, unless I wash you, you have no part with me. Unless I wash you, you have no part with me. So, how you should allow him to wash? You have to draw near to him. Lord, please wash. Whatever that is there in me, please wash. I humble myself. If you run away from God, how you wash? You will not chase running. Okay, let's go for running race now. Right? We have to draw near to him for him to wash. If on that day when Jesus was washing his feet, Peter would have ran away. Sorry God, sorry. You are so holy, I'm a sinner. He says that unless I wash you, you have no part with me. He was like a rebuke. Unless I wash you, you have no part with me. Right? That's what he's saying now. Unless I wash you, you have no part with me. Don't run away from me. Better be coming to me. Okay, that is what Jesus is saying. Amen. Hallelujah. So see the great love of God. See, we need to understand this great love. Amen. Hallelujah. In Hebrews 2:11 it says, for both he who sanctifies, Hebrews 2:11, for both he who sanctifies and those who are being sanctified are all of one, for which reason he is not ashamed to call them brethren. So he is calling us as brothers. Come, I'll wash you. I'll make you as a holy thing acceptable to God. Come, draw near to me. Come to me. Jesus said, right, all those who are weary and heavy laden, come to me, I will give you rest. We are wearied and filled with guilt and condemnation, and we are, it's like a big baggage in our mind and heart. Jesus saying, come, I'll give you rest. Amen. Hallelujah. So we need to draw near to Him. That is what will make you holy. Don't run around and start doing things that you will think that, oh, I need to meet this standard. You will never know that standard. If your manager always says, hey, you have to achieve this, you have to, only then I'll give you a good appraisal. Right? And you never say that, what is that standard? You will always be running, struggling, and you will always, every appraisal you will say, no, you have not met the standard. I will give you less only. No. You always need to know what is the standard. That standard you will get only when we draw near to God. He will give the standard to you. And it'll be so joyful, and without your effort, that God will make you holy. And when you draw near to Him, you will get strength, you will receive the grace and mercy in the time of need, so that you will not fall away again. Otherwise, you will be in this vicious cycle of guilt and condemnation, more condemnation, and you'll become a big depot of guilt and condemnation, and you will start making others also miserable. Okay? God has called us for an abundant life. Abundant life. Just think whether you are living that abundant life. The abundant life is nothing but righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. The joy is gone, the peace is gone, means khatam. The enemy has taken a ride over us. Amen. So don't try to run for, oh, I need to be holy. Draw near to God. Worship Him in spirit and truth. Right? And His cleansing power will make you and enable you to live a holy life more and more. Amen. 1 John 4:17. 1 John 4:17. John is writing about a boldness here.
Here is our love, made perfect, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment. Because as He is, so are we in this world.
Amen. So love has been perfected among us in this. If we don't draw near to God, the love will not be perfected. You will always have a fear to run away from Him. So when we draw near to God, what happens? The love will be perfected among us in this, that we may have boldness the day of judgment. We will not be worried about the day of judgment when God is going to judge all His people. Amen. We will stand boldly, because we will not stand with our standard. Lord, I thought this is the holiness standard. Now you are seeing something else. No, we will not stand like that, because we will stand with the standard of Jesus Christ. Because He has made us worthy. It is not our effort to trying to do. It will come when we draw near to Him. Amen. And we will stand with the standard of Jesus' holiness. Because He has purchased us. He has sanctified us by the Spirit. He has sanctified us when we put our faith in Him. Amen. And we are being made holy when we are drawn near to Him, and He is making us perfect. We are being sanctified. That's when it happens. Amen. Hallelujah. So this is called the renewing of mind. Okay, and this is how we make ourselves holy, both in our body and our mind, because the mind is the one that has to be renewed first. When we are thinking right in our mind, our actions will be right. Right? We will be more joyful, and we will encourage a brother who's, if he is going through some kind of a temptation. See, only if we always preach holiness, okay, and what happens is people will not be able to understand it. Okay, and even if they are going through some kind of a trouble, they will not be able to open to us. They will think that, hey, these people are some high standard people. Probably they are living such a high. Nobody will know that this guy also is going through the same thing. Okay, and they will not open. And because of that, what happens when you don't open and share? That's how the fellowship is not there. And when the fellowship is not there, people are all living in isolation in the church. That's why we saw today, right? We will break dividing walls. Amen. You want us to be together. Build each other up. Encourage each other up. Paul is writing, if you are happy, sing a song together. Right? So he's talking about a unity there. Right? And that's how we'll go. See, no, don't think Anybody has attained that perfection, okay, never think. Let's read this portion. 1 Corinthians 10:13.
No temptation has seized you except what is common to man.
That's it. But God is faithful, who will not allow.
He will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. But when you are tempted, He will also provide a way out so that you can stand up under it.
Amen. Hallelujah. No temptation has overtaken you except that is common to man. Which is saying that, hey guys, everybody are going through the same thing. Don't think you are super holy, you are going through a lot of temptation. Everybody are facing the same thing. It is common to man. Okay. But it says, but God is faithful. When He will be faithful, when you draw near to God, it says that with the temptation, He will also make a way of escape. How He, if you don't go with God, how will He will get a way of escape? You are running away another direction. He will make a way of escape. Okay, you have to draw near to Him so that He will make a way of escape for you when you are tempted. Amen. Hallelujah. Understand that God is our strength always. It's not that He has left you alone. He said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. I will never leave you nor forsake you. It is us, we think in our mind that God has forsaken us and we run away from God. No, don't do that. Amen. So, don't think that if some preachers or big shots in the Christian circle preaching, oh, holy, be holy, be holy. Believe that He is also a man. He is also going through the same temptation. Okay. Only when we see that person's life, we will know. Okay. Yes, people mature. As they grow in the Lord, people mature. But think that I will never become holy unless I come to God. Okay. I need to always need to come near to God, receive His mercy and grace in the time of need. Otherwise, gone. I can never be holy. So don't have some kind of a standard. Somebody is preaching you. You have to do these things, brother. Only then you will become holy. No. That standard is not the standard according to the Bible. The standard is drawn near to Him. Amen. That's the standard. So people who are wise like me says, it says, right, like Paul, it says, he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you. My strength is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, most gladly, I will rather boast in my infirmities that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Amen. Hallelujah. So, his power has to rest upon. So, any temptation that is there in your life, always have happened to run to Him. Open your heart to Him. It is not that God is rejecting you. He's always welcoming you. Otherwise, how He would have written all these verses? Right? Enter boldly into the throne of grace. Receive mercy. If God is such an angry God and a God who doesn't want to help us, why He should write these things? Right? So, anything that you go in your life, whether good or bad, always have a heart to run to Him. It is like a child running to the Father. He will not reject us. Even in your uttermost mistake, He will not reject us. Only when you run to Him, He will make you such a person that you would have, after a period of time, you would have, how did I overcome all these things? You will be amazed by the way the Lord is working in your life. Amen. And that is what will give you more boldness to stand for Him. Amen. Hallelujah. So, as we saw that as a man think he is, so is he. Right? And that's how when we are renewed in our mind, our actions will automatically follow. So, don't base your holiness based on your action. Base your holiness on how to draw to God, get renewed in your mind so that actions will automatically follow that. Amen. Hallelujah. So remember, without the continuous work of Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit and His truth washing our hearts and minds continually, we will never become holy in our life. Don't run after something else. Amen. Hallelujah. So let the righteousness, peace and joy in the Holy Ghost, let that be our kingdom always. If you are losing peace and joy, check back, run to Him. Lord, something is happening in my life. I want this peace and joy back. Righteousness is already there. He has made us righteous. Okay. The peace and joy is the one which is missing. We are running away from God. So all the time, run to Him so that you are. See, I tell you, when the church is renewed in their mind, and when we know, it's like a bomb. Okay, it will just explode and change people like anything, in and out. Okay, and because the believers are empowered by this truth, they will automatically, the rivers of living water will flow from their life. When we are filled, when we know what God has done in our life, when we are filled, we'll be so joyful that river will flow, will touch people. People will ask, what is making you so joyful? What is making you so happy? Right? And then you will share. Because your life will become a testimony in that time. Amen. So let's all know this truth. Let this truth will set us free. Amen. Let's close our eyes.